Afternoon and welcome to the seventh episode of the Holler Pod podcast by Searchability. I'm your host, Olly Preston, and today we're going to be talking all things employer branding, specifically for recruitment agencies. We're joined by two of our in-house experts this afternoon. We're joined by Sophie Hopley and Leah Cottham. Afternoon, ladies.
Hello.
Hi.
How does it feel to be on the other side of the camera?
Very weird, isn't it?
A bit uncomfortable, but I'm sure we'll settle right in soon.
You'll be fine, you'll be fine. For a bit of insight for any of the listeners or watchers out there, Soph and Leah are the geniuses behind this very podcast. Along with Chloe, they provide quite a lot of the insights, the creativity. Basically, they write it and tell me what to say. They also regularly tell me off for swearing, so I'm expecting a very clean pod. Fair, ladies?
Yeah.
Our best.
We'll try.
Today you're taking center stage. Very quick background. Sophie has been with Searchability forever, pretty much since the very start, and Leah's just completed her fifth year.
Yeah, 5 years.
First stint, ladies. I think you've actually had the longest tenure of any two people sat on this sofa, so you know, good commitment. I love that. So today's pod coincides nicely with the relaunch or the rebrand of our in-house employer branding platform, Holler, formerly Job Holler.
Yeah, it's getting weird even just saying Holler instead of Job Holler, but we're getting used to it, aren't we?
We are now, yeah.
And I know it's a journey you two girls are particularly proud of. So the plan for today's pod is to introduce Holler, provide an insight into employer branding, and discuss specifically how recruitment companies can build, shape, and promote their brand, right?
Exactly.
Nailed
that.
Nailed it. Cool. I've had a lot of exposure to this over the years. You know, I think about where we started versus where we are now, and it's been one hell of a journey. You know, I started Searchability in 2016 and trying to get the seniors or the old school recruiters to buy in to employer branding was a challenge, and I include myself in that bracket. But we've definitely grown as an organisation. You know, when I look back, There's some laughable moments, but first of the months always tend to spring to mind. I think that's the clearest example of how this journey's improved.
Yeah, 100%.
For anyone listening who's not experienced with recruitment, we do something called first of the month, and that effectively allows us to describe how the month before has gone, talk about the KPIs, the data, etc. And I always remember we used to put Twitter impressions on the slide every single month, and you'd have the likes of Gabby, who is young and coming through at the time with about 8 million impressions, and Paddy Doyle, who always had zero.
I think you mean at Digi Doyle.
Oh, at Digi Doyle. Yeah, that's so it. It's now
the only one with that
his name
as well.
Yeah. We're now 7 years on, and I'm pretty sure Paddy still hasn't done a tweet. He'd probably bollock me for saying that, but he definitely won't listen to the podcast either. So, stress there. Luckily, he's a good biller. It's fair to say we've come on leaps and bounds since then, and you girls will tell us a lot more about that journey. Right, ladies, I'm going off piece a bit there. So, we've got a lot to discuss. And before we get really stuck in, well, you effectively wrote the pod, so you know what's to come next, but.
Well, to be fair, you're going to throw in a few questions to throw us off our game.
I'm going to try. It wasn't very easy without your guidance, I'm not going to lie. But first, you know the score. GBA, the good, the bad and the awkward. Mm-hmm. Effectively, this gives you guys the chance to tell us a little bit of an awkward story to break the ice and get those creative juices flowing. Yeah, have you decided who's going to go?
I thought I would give one because I've got quite a good one that's like recruitment focused, because obviously this is a recruitment podcast. So before I joined Searchability, I'd probably had no interactions with recruiters. I'd always got jobs through like applying direct to the company or had my own business or whatever. But before I got my job at Searchability, I didn't realise that if you applied to a job on a job board and probably ticked a small print box, it meant that
everybody called you.
Yeah, all of the recruiters had access to your data and they could ring you. Because all of a sudden I was getting phone calls from people about jobs that I hadn't applied to. Anyway, I worked in marketing, but my role had kind of turned into a bit of sales because there's always like a little bit of a crossover.
Yeah.
I was working in property marketing at the time. So someone called me a rector rec, and he basically sold me the dream about recruitment, and you know, it did sound good. And I wasn't very happy where I was. So even though I wanted to get a job in marketing, you know, I took the time, I spoke to him and I was like, yeah, actually, I think, you know, I'd be up for coming to this interview. Anyway, he rings me the next day and says, look, I've lined you up 2 interviews right on your doorstep at recruitment agencies in Chester.
Evolved quickly.
Was with Searchability. I was like, yeah, great. And then that night I was like, you know what? I don't want to not work in marketing. Like I'm, you know, I shouldn't be doing this. So I did what every recruiter absolutely hates. I dropped the email, pulled me out the interview, and then I stopped answering his calls.
Ooh.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I was that person. But, you know, I ghosted him. He was literally leaving me voicemails, emails. He was phoning me around the clock. I was ignoring his calls. And I think what he must have done, I think maybe he rang me off a different number.
Clever. I like that. Yeah, I'm used to that one.
Yeah, just to get around. So anyway, he managed to get me and I was like, oh, it's him. But he said, look, I spoke to Martin and he actually wants to hire someone in marketing. So I was like, oh, okay. So I went along to the interview. So very nearly didn't come for the job interview. But I went along, me and Martin got on really well. And the interview went great. And then it was like right at the end, he basically turned around and was like, oh, do you know anyone that works in recruitment? And again, because I've never worked in recruitment before, I didn't realize
you told him
saying this was a bad thing. I was like, oh, my boyfriend at the time is an IT recruiter at another agency in Chester. And he was like, brilliant. Thinking, oh, God, I don't want to hire this girl now because, you know, she's going to have access to data that I maybe don't want shared. Anyway, he took a chance on me. Offered me the job. That relationship was dead long before I even joined Searchability. So I always think of it as like a sliding door moment. Like if I'd have never answered the phone to that recruiter, like basically, obviously my career has now evolved quite a lot since I've joined.
The butterfly effect.
But you know, I met my husband here and we have a son together. So it's like, where would we be if I hadn't have ghosted that recruiter? So that's the moral of the story. You should always
answer the phone to recruiters. And always answer the phone when they call you off a different number.
Yeah,
is that the message?
Yeah, that's how they'll get you. But it could change your life. So be open to the conversation.
So the good is it can change your life. That's really deep. Good. The bad
was, I suppose, that, you know, he was annoying me that much, this recruiter, that, you know, I very nearly just sacked it off.
And the awkward was that you had a boyfriend at the time and you left him very shortly afterwards.
And then when I joined as well, and like obviously Martin thought he'd offered me this job with this boyfriend at the time that worked in recruitment.
That he was going to poach probably.
And he was trying to be nice and he was like, oh, how's your boyfriend or something? And I was like, oh, we broke up. And his reply was, oh, great. And he was like, oh, I mean, oh.
What do I say?
Like, oh, it's fine. Like, it wasn't bad. But it just made me laugh that he was like, brilliant news.
Love that. Great story to kick us off. Out of interest, Leah, would you have shared anything?
Well, I was originally thinking about the interview process as well. So Searchability sponsored Tramier Rovers Football Club. And I actually used to work for Tramier as a hostess. So originally applying... With the mostess, yeah. Obviously. So I sat down and Martin's like, oh, I've seen you work for Tramier. I was like, yeah. And he was like, oh, well, I'm going to match later, so you better be good. Otherwise, it's going to be dead awkward, isn't it? And I was just like, but then obviously the interview went good. And then he offered me the job literally straight after. And
I was there that night, actually. Yeah.
At the time, I didn't know. Obviously,
you were very youthful.
And I was putting wristbands on you, taking you up to the room. But yeah, now it's weird to actually go and be the person that I once gave the response to. So yeah, it's a great little...
You come full circle.
Yeah.
All right, cool. No, great stories, ladies. Thank you for that. Right, okay, let's... I feel like this could be quite a substantial podcast, this. I know you girls are both very passionate about this particular subject. So let's dive in. Let's start at the very beginning for beginners like me.
Yes.
And tell us about Holler, formerly Job Holler. What's the crack?
Okay, so I'll probably lead with this one because I've been here a little bit longer than Leah. So when I joined back in 2015, essentially we had at Searchability a bit of a recruitment marketing product that we sold on to clients, which was essentially like branded adverts.
Yeah.
And, you know, at the time there weren't a lot of people offering that, but Martin had asked me, you know, I want you to have a look at this product and see how we can develop it and try and maximize this as, you know, a saleable entity at Searchability. So started looking into it. Now, I had a background in marketing, but obviously very little understanding of the recruitment industry. So had to kind of go back to basics a little bit and do a bit of research on that side, and kind of fell down a bit of a rabbit hole with employer branding. And, you know, as you'll know at the time, Ollie, like, recruiters would never disclose who their client was in an advert.
Ever.
Yeah. Because essentially that's how you'd make your fee, right? So if you were to give away who the end client was and they applied directly, you're lost doing yourself out bit. Of a fee. So it was almost unheard of to actually have this as a solution at a recruitment agency.
Yeah. Breaking the mold.
But yeah, Martin was very bold, saying, you know, I want to be different to the pack. I want to kind of maximize our marketing. And he was so confident that we were going to offer this as a standalone solution because he knew in the quality of, you know, headhunting talent.
Yeah.
You know, that can't kind of be matched with, you know, advertising necessarily. So this was a solution that we were looking at. I ended up kind of looking into employer branding, needed to get a bit more experience in it. So I came across Brett Minchington, who is the World Employer Branding Day founder. He leads Employer Brand International. He's the most published author on employer branding.
Big deal then.
Yeah, so I couldn't really find like a better authority on the subject. So I kind of reached out to him and was like, I'm looking for events or some, you know, courses. He kind of spearheaded this Employer Branding Day conference and mentioned that, but also had these courses that you could go on to become an employer brand leader.
Yeah.
So that's a course that I undertook back in 2016, I think it was now. And now it's something that everyone that joins Holler goes through as part of their onboarding process. So we were kind of looking at employer branding from like the candidate attraction angle, when really like it's a full service entity. You know, it's all about engaging your employees,
yeah,
retaining employees. So once we'd kind of gone through that process, it became so apparent that, you know, there was this untapped area of employer branding that we just weren't hitting with looking only at recruitment marketing.
We were just scratching the surface, effectively. Yeah.
So we kind of took that information to put into our technology product, which became Job Holler. And over the years, we sort of added to that in terms of our service offering, our clients, and, you know, you naturally evolve what you're doing because of, yeah, what, you know, the market's asking for. So over the years, we've just sort of grown as an agency. And then that's why this year we decided it was the right time for a rebrand. So Job Holler lost the job, became Holler.
Nice.
So it reflects the fact that we're no longer just looking at shouting about jobs. You know, it's about everything.
The full service.
Yeah. And so obviously I've been there since the start with Holler, not Job Holler. And Leah joined me. I mean, what year was it that you moved over to our side now? You can probably tell us a bit about your journey.
Yeah, so it was maybe like, was it 2.5, 3 years ago-ish, maybe?
Yeah, check LinkedIn.
Yeah.
Bobble
got
now.
Got brought on as the graduate researcher, which again was a new thing that Martin had started, a graduate programme within the business. Got brought on again to do things a little bit differently, having a look at the way the tech community works, doing blogs, created a whole new standalone thing called Hollering. So it was just seeing what was happening within the tech world, and that obviously really did interest me. And then I remember Soph put in, it was a job out, and I was just like emailing her like, can we have a conversation about this? She came over like, yeah, obviously. Like, so that hybrid role took place quite quick, and then from there moved straight into the full-time marketing role and then the employer branding, and then it just took off from there really. And then Soph went on maternity for a year. That's why she's been gone for a year. And then, yeah, she's back. And, yeah, we've rebranded to Holler and it's ready to go.
All systems go. It's just good timing because obviously we're expanding across the world.
Literally.
We've got Australia that's just opened. We've got the US office, which is opening in officially in January. It's all systems go. Out of interest, Leah, how was that learning curve while Sophie was on maternity?
Yeah, do you know what? She actually left the best handbook I've ever seen, ever. Soph loves...
I'm a control freak.
Yeah. I was going to say perfection, but to have everything down to a T has always been what Soph's done. So she just put everything in a PDF that everything she knew. So if I had any questions,
and you had to read it all,
I'd go back to that.
Yeah.
It's like a little
control
booklet. Control F. Search for a word, found it. If not, I'd give her a message. But yeah, it was like the perfect smooth sailing. The end of the process. She sort of let me do my own thing, take on my own clients, and the process was really smooth. So it's really helped.
Nice. Okay, and that brings us to the current day. But let's go backwards a little bit for any of those listeners that I've got no idea what we're talking about. Let's start at the beginning. So what is employer branding in layman's terms? What is it?
Well, I'm not sure I'll give it to you in layman's terms. Okay. My best. The official definition is all about the image of your organisation as a great place to work. Now, that's in the mind of your current employees, but also key stakeholders in the external market. So we tend to think about it as your employees and your potential candidates. They're the main kind of two markets that you'd be looking at. Now, it has a lot of aligning concepts with like corporate branding.
Yeah.
Instead of talking about your products, it's about your people. And, you know, a lot of it can't be felt or touched. It's, you know, emotion. It's like how you make people feel. But you can bring it to life through different touch points within the employee experience and the candidate experience.
Okay.
Now, one thing that a lot of people maybe don't realize is that whether they manage it or not, every single organization has an employer brand. It already exists.
Whether that be good or bad.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, okay.
So the fact is that, you know, if you leave it alone, it might not be performing how you want it to be. So the strongest employee brands out there are the companies that understand the importance of it, and they're taking the time to actually discover it, shape it, and promote it.
Okay. Tell me more.
Okay. Well, that's probably like the kind of explanation of what employer branding is. But
okay, so maybe I should rephrase that then. Yeah. So if we, obviously today's pod's all about, well, we always come back to recruitment. So that's a bit more of an overview. How can we make that specific to recruitment? What does employer branding look like specifically for a recruitment agency, for example?
Okay, so we can probably use Searchability as a bit of an example for this. Because obviously we are a recruitment agency and we look after the employer brand for Searchability.
Yeah.
So the only things that you'd probably need to be mindful of in terms of employer branding for recruitment are the same things that you'd need to think about in any industry. The fact is you have your corporate brand, which is aimed at your customers. So if we're talking about Searchability, that's people looking for a job in IT or companies that are recruiting in IT. You know, our clients and our candidates, that's kind of like our customer base.
Yeah.
But that's a very different audience to who we want to come and work for Searchability. So you've got two completely separate audiences there. So that's something that you need to really kind of think about in terms of recruitment specifically. But in terms of showcasing your employer brand, I mean, we'll dig down into the kind of strategic side of how you would kind of pull that out and discover and shape it. But just off the top of my head in terms of recruitment, I'd say that it's really important that you're remembering about those audiences, because you don't want to be putting content out to attract people to come and work for you that you wouldn't want your best client to see.
You're always thinking about what you're actually being portrayed as, effectively.
Yeah, it's a real like kind of line that you've got to tread. If you want to kind of promote yourself as a very work hard, play hard, you know, got loads of social events, you know, kind of like what Searchability is like.
Yeah.
But, you know, your clients maybe don't want to see everyone getting drunk on a social event.
True.
All over social media. You need to kind of strike the balance. So make sure that when you're going out to showcase your employer brand, you're not just leaning too far on like the social side.
Yeah.
Making sure you're also representing yourself in a professional way. Just, I always say, just kind of filter it. Don't put anything out into the internet that you wouldn't want your best client to see, basically.
Yeah, okay. So there's literally like two different channels going on simultaneously, ultimately.
Yeah, and you may find that you want to use certain channels to showcase your employer brand, certain channels to showcase your corporate brand. There will also be crossover on some channels, but it's always just thinking back to those audiences.
Yeah, okay. No, that makes perfect sense, right? So obviously Searchability are quite a way down this road now because of the investment and time that you girls have put in. But let's assume, for the sake of this conversation, that I've just started my own recruitment company or I'm a year in. You know, how would I go about building what you guys have built? How do I build my own employer brand within a relatively young organization? Where do I start?
Yeah, so I'll probably jump in with this one. Sorry, I feel like I'm talking.
No, it's
there.
Okay.
But so obviously there's quite a lot of steps to it, and we won't kind of delve into the full nitty gritty because conscious that we're trying to keep this down to an hour or less.
We'll see.
We'll do our best. But essentially, I'll talk you through a few of the steps that we would take at Holler if we were working with one of our clients. Now, we think about it as three different sections. So discover, shape, and then promote.
Yeah.
So the discovery phase, step one, we would always say carry out what we call like a desktop discovery. So ideally, you want a third party to do this, because if you're doing it yourself, you may kind of have the blinkers on or too much bias to kind of really look at what a potential candidate might see. So we'd say, you know, think of being a candidate, looking on your websites, looking on your social channels, reading your Glassdoor. Like, what kind of picture are they painting about working for you by like finding all of that information online? That could be videos, photos, reviews, testimonials, social posts, content on your website. All of that will start to shape in a person's mind what your employer brand is.
Yeah.
Taking all of that information, you should have like a bit of an idea of where the employer brand sits. So that's like a really good starting point anyway, because like I say, it already exists, whether you like it or not. Second step, I'd always say assemble an employer brand team, because if you really want to kind of get this off the ground and make an impact, you're going to need that internal buy-in to actually bring it to life. So ideally, you want some like senior people, like your directors, CEOs, managers to be involved. HR obviously have a big role to play, any internal recruitment, marketing. But then, you know, if you're thinking about recruitment, you might have different departments. You might want different representations from across, you know, the software dev team or the contracts team or whatever it would be. But then also thinking about who's going to be a good brand champion for you. So you might not just want to have all senior people. You might want to get some, you know, more junior members of staff involved, or people that are quite active on social media, etc. So once you've got that team assembled, I'd then look at measuring employee engagement. So that usually would be like a bit of a survey, anonymous feedback, which, you know,
this terrifies me.
Some home truths, but you know, the fact is, like, the strongest brands are built from hearing the absolute worst things about yourself. So it's better to know it in a survey so you can act and change.
Is it?
Than waiting until it's just plastered all over your Glassdoor and
well, that's true.
And you've lost that person. So getting all of that information in through an employee engagement survey, that should give you, you know, a good starting point in terms of data to actually look at what you need to do to shape it.
So
I think the engagement survey is a really good way to uncover the information of what you can do to change. Say, actually, this isn't where I want my employer brand to be. I want to be up there with, you know, the top employers to work for. So, you know, we are scoring low for, I don't know, corporate social responsibility or flexible working or whatever it would be. And then seeing, actually, is there anything that we could do to impact that change internally? It's not going to happen overnight, but that's where you're going to get all of the information to actually improve it as an organization. And then step five, once you've measured all of that employee engagement, you can actually start to uncover what your employer value proposition is.
Right. Okay.
You've
lost me. Employee value proposition. Should I know?
Well, maybe as a director of business, but the purposes of the podcast, we'll delve into it. I think me and Leah sometimes forget that we kind of talk in jargon sometimes, and we'll just say
EVP. I recognize EVP.
So EVP, employer value proposition. So that's basically a set of associations and offerings that you can offer to an employee in exchange for their skills and capabilities that they bring to the workforce. So think beyond like the benefits that you would offer, you know, it's more about, you know, what you can give them in terms of like the culture, career development opportunities. It's how you're going to, you know, position yourself as differently from your competition.
Yeah.
Basically.
Okay.
Usually it's got a nice catchy tagline. So I think like Apple's, for example, is join us, be you.
Smooth.
Which doesn't really say everything, but then if you delve down more into it, it talks about the fact that, you know, it's an opportunity to find your purpose and, you know, they're celebrating different thinking and stuff. So you get the idea. It's all about having a nice, obviously we're in marketing, essentially we're going to have a tagline, but, you know, it has to be backed up by something that actually makes sense.
Yeah. Okay.
Once you've got your EVP, you then work that into what we call the employer brand architecture, which is like the blueprint and the guidelines that you would use to communicate the employer brand. So if I were to go off on maternity leave, for example, I would leave a guideline for Leah so she would know the exact colours, typefaces, the tone of voice that she can use to communicate the brand. She would have like all the taglines, all of the information, so that you've got consistency across all aspects of your employer brand. That's really important if you're going to be having more than one person doing this, which most people are.
Yeah.
And let's say you're using a rec to rec, for example, you want them to have a good understanding of that employer brand so they're not mis-selling you on a job advert, for example. So that's a really, really key point. And then step six is the fun part, the promoting. So, you know, thinking about how you're going to bring that employer brand to life through content, so videos, images, blogs, podcasts, whatever it would be, you know, across your socials, your website. So that's the bit where we, you know, have the most fun.
Definitely.
Socials. Talk to me about socials. Obviously, I know the basics here, but how do you promote yourself via socials? Where do we start?
So social media, there's not a one pot fits all. Is that it? Saying one
is that it?
One shoe fits all. Is it?
I don't know. I'm lost.
Anyway,
one size fits
that's
all.
The one.
That's
anyway,
it. Yeah.
So. But I would say there's some main social medias that you do want to sort of focus on a little bit more. Being in recruitment, LinkedIn is one of our main tools that we definitely use. It's a professional network where clients and candidates both communicate on the platform. It allows you to share company news on there. You can do job openings on there. If somebody applies for a job, you actually gain a follower from that. The more jobs you have, the more followers you gain. You can sort of put employee testimonials on there. It's a great way to sort of showcase your business from that point of view, but also your employees can say that they work for you as well. So they can start posting stuff about the company on there, and it creates that employee advocacy so they can see, oh, they work for Searchability and they're posting about that. Oh, must be a great company to work for. Next, not so much of a sort of social media platform, but I would say a platform is Glassdoor.
I'm not a fan as a general rule.
Yeah, it seems like a scary concept, but I think it can only be scary if you've got sort of something to hide and you feel like you've got negative things that is going to be plastered on there. So you just need to be conscious of that, and people will leave reviews, whether they're current, whether they've maybe just been in the interview process or they've just left the business. A great way to sort of do that is through in an exit interview, making sure you sort of tailor that journey and making sure that if there is anything that they're maybe feeling a bit negative about, just to say it in that, then the Glassdoor can always be showcased as a great way to sort of showcase who you are.
Yeah.
Because people who are looking for a job, they're going to search the company's Glassdoor. That's just the way it is.
They are, right? Maybe this is just my naivety a little bit here, right? But if I ever go to any platform like that, and I know a lot of people are the same, if you have a good experience on in a company, at a restaurant, whatever it may be, I quite rarely would leave a review. Maybe that's wrong of me.
Yeah.
But if you have a negative experience, people are much more likely to go to those platforms and leave a review. And I imagine that's never more poignant than in an organisization, right? I know our Glassdoor is actually pretty good as a general rule, but people who currently work within that organisation won't leave a Glassdoor typically. There are exceptions to that rule, but you won't. Only people that move on will either talk about their good or bad experience. But everyone who, let's take Searchability, everyone who loves working at Searchability, for example, is still there, typically. Whereas the people that aren't have left for whatever reason. So surely more people leave negative reviews than positive.
Yes, but that's why you do have to incorporate it into your employer brand and social media strategy, because you need to know that that's happening.
Yeah.
And if there's going to be positive photos on there, you can tailor your Glassdoor to have photos. You can do salary uploads. People can do interview updates on there. So it will be a point of call that potential employees will visit. So you need to be aware of that.
Do you? So Glassdoor specifically for existing employees, or no, I mean employees for searchability, you wouldn't get a client leaving a Glassdoor.
No,
okay.
That would be more like Google or Trustpilot.
Google or Trustpilot. Okay, so, but okay, so are they all just as valuable as one another?
But yes, so then I'd also say social media platforms for showcasing the employer brand is definitely Instagram. That's one that we tailor a lot of our searchability. Instagram platform is very tailored to that sort of culture, values, social days, well-being days. That's like a visual behind the scenes representation of searchability. A lot of people also tag searchability. You can reshare on there. And then more recently as well, TikTok, a short engaging video can showcase what it's like to work for your business. So they're all sort of different platforms to use in different ways. One can be more of a corporate news side, one's Glassdoor to keep an eye out for. Instagram's the visual representation, TikTok you can have a little bit of fun with. So I reckon they're all
good. And okay, now that makes sense. And if... It's not some of these things can cost money, right? You have to invest a lot to get to where you need to get to in recruitment, especially when you're starting a new company. Is there like an order of priority? If you could only choose one platform as a startup in recruitment, which would it be?
Yeah, well, I think LinkedIn's a great one in terms of putting your company out there and creating a company profile, because from there, most of people will search the LinkedIn. But a budget-free solution is employee advocacy. If your people who work for your company truly believe it's a great place to work, they're going to be posting great content online, amazing things you've done, and it'll be free for you to gain free exposure from all of their connections online, whether that is Instagram or LinkedIn, and they do a post, it's free. So that'll be a great way to
showcase that. That's something that we started at Searchability. So I remember when I first joined, and like you say, we're very much a social media advocate, but you know, it was a bit of a slower burner in terms of using that for the employer brand and not just finding candidates. So we were trying to encourage people, you know, make sure you're sharing stuff and asking them to post pictures of when we did events. And you know, it starts off real slow and you've got to keep reminding people. And you know, the easiest ways we found to actually get people to share this sort of content was firstly make a hashtag. Yeah. So the hashtag Searchability Life, it's pretty easy to remember. You know, hopefully everyone does.
I do it sometimes.
Even Holly does it. So if something good is happening at work, feel free to share something on your socials, whether it's your personal or your work. Use the hashtag Searchability Life. It means that we get visibility of that. We can then potentially reshare it, and then obviously we've got a nice raft of employee generated content to go out for the employer brand as well, but also just giving people a reason to share. So you don't just want to say, actually, you know, can you share something about liking working for us? If you give them a good experience, you don't have to ask them to do that.
Yeah.
So it's investing time into what you're delivering as a company for your employees as well. So when we do, you know, your wellness days or the First Friday events, or take people to the awards, or take people to like an overseas conference, you know, it's a nice thing people want to share anyway. So you find that naturally people start to share stuff. And you know, obviously we were talking before about different audiences. You know, your LinkedIn might be full of potential people looking for a job through you, or potential clients. You know, none of them are probably going to come and work for you, whereas your employees are going to be connected with like-minded people, local people, people they worked with before, they might have done university courses together. Like, essentially, this is like your target candidate demographic.
You're casting the net wide there, yeah, aren't you, ultimately?
And then, say, Leah shares a post about, you know, doing a podcast today and how she's having a nice day at work.
You better.
You bet. And you know, someone that she's connected with might see that, and then when we ultimately post that next job opening, they may end up applying. And a lot of the time when we've had people apply to our roles, often that first candidate touch point they've had is seeing a TikTok or an Instagram post that, you know, somebody shared that works for us, rather than just an advert on Indeed.
Yeah, and that actually does work. Yeah. I'm not just saying this because I host a Searchability podcast, or because you girls are sat here. I'm pretty long in the tooth. I'm not social media savvy. If I'm doing something at Searchability related, without even thinking, I do hashtag Searchability Life. And all my mates see that. If someone else within Searchability reposts it, all their mates see that. The actual audience that you're reaching out to is.
Yeah, it actually happened this week, literally.
Go on.
Clickstarters are sort of sister company, which is early careers. We've just had someone do a TikTok mentioning Clickstarters to go on our LinkedIn and follow us and go on our jobs. And it's crazy what one person advocating about one thing on social media can link to our LinkedIn. And yeah, just shows.
Just getting the right person to promote your brand at the right time could make a monumental difference. Yeah. No, it is cool. It's crazy. Okay, so that's quite that's quite a broad overview. So every company could integrate all of those things. Is there anything specific that a recruitment agency might need to consider?
Well, obviously we mentioned earlier about those audiences and treading the line of, you know, professional to fun content.
Having your different channels.
Yeah, I know that's something that we had to think extra hard about. Obviously, it's something that is in the top of your mind anyway, any agency. But when we launched the National Security and Defence branch last year, I think it was.
Completely different proposition.
They're obviously placing, you know, highest level security cleared technical professionals into you know, government roles within the UK. You know, it's a real serious stuff. So it's whether they want to see their MD, you know, dressed up as a banana on the Works First Friday.
He wouldn't do that.
Yeah, I know he's a big fan of fancy dress, Will Roebuck.
He is.
Yeah, it's thinking about, okay, well, what content, you know, is best being put out to promote their employer brand. So you've got to kind of always have that kind of filter cap on when you are posting anything externally.
Yeah.
Also, things to be mindful of are the fact that in recruitment, we'll use a lot of platforms like Indeed, but for our clients. So, you know, at Searchability, for example, I'd say 99% of the jobs on Indeed would be like software developer, IT roles.
Yeah, it's a bit like confusing from an outside point of view.
But there's a way that you can also share photos and information about your company on there in terms of your employer brand, which is fine if you're, you know, Apple sharing that information.
Yeah.
But essentially, there's no point us sharing information about the Searchability employer brand to people that are going to go and work at our clients across the UK. So it can be a little bit confusing. So it's just always being mindful of those platforms that may have those double audiences and just making sure that you're getting that across in like the content that you're sharing on the profile.
Okay, so it's just literally considering every possible outcome, I guess, to a certain degree, and being careful about what you post and when you post it.
Yeah, you want to share like stuff that's going to make people want to come and work for you. So don't like hold back per se, but just remember your platforms. And that's why it's quite a good argument. So like Leah was saying there before about, you know, a TikTok and Instagram. At Searchability, we have those reserved 100% for our employer brand. So we would never really use the Instagram or the TikTok to market to clients or potential candidates.
No.
They're all kind of reserved for showcasing the employer brand. So we can be a little bit more fun.
A little bit of poetic license.
Leah and Chloe, like, you know, they pull a lot of content together that's a little bit more fun. You know, they very much look after the TikTok. I don't really get involved.
Why, Soph?
I'm a little bit more seasoned than these two girls. But yeah, I leave them to it because they're the masters of TikTok.
Yeah, we hope.
Okay, no, cool. We're talking a lot there about the positive impact that these can have on your audiences. You know, we talk about Clickstarters there having a great bit of feedback from TikTok. We all see the positive reviews we get on Trustpilot, on Glassdoor from our own employees, from LinkedIn when we place a candidate, right? It's all you know, rosy a lot of the time, but let's be honest, we do also get some negativity. And that's not just us. You're going to get that in any organisation you work with. You're never going to get 100% of your employees or clients or candidates being 100% happy. So if you are investing a lot of time into your employer brand, how do you deal with the negative side? Because we touched on it before, you know, people do have a moan when they leave. People do have a moan if they don't get a job. How do you deal with that?
Yeah, so probably going back to that, the Glassdoor style of things, but you do have to take into account that people will have something to say. It might be small, it might be big, but you just need to listen and understand what they're saying. It might be something that you didn't really realise that was happening, something that might be a little bit picky for that person, but if you can create a recruitment process that does understand at the very end of their journey, maybe, oh, is there a reason why you are leaving? Or and they say something, maybe it's a little bit negative, trying to listen and understand why they've thought that before they immediately leave the door and they go straight to a review site and leave a review, because otherwise you can't sort of stop that before it's happening.
Yeah.
In some cases, people can still be a little bit angry and leave a review, and you do need to understand that this can happen. But in this case, you need to read it and engage and straight away communicate and reply back. Never just leave it and never reply, because otherwise it's just going to be there and it's never going to be understood why that was there in the first place. So I'd definitely say sort of see a reply. Don't ever be very argumentative on the post, because then it just causes uproar.
What about if you're really annoyed?
Gotta hold it. You gotta keep strong, because at the end of the day, they have worked. If, for example, if they've worked for you, they were once an employee, so there's got to be a bit of understanding there, and just find out sort of what happened. But also at the end, you can sort of give a reason to give a phone call or an email and maybe take it away to discuss it in a little bit more detail. From this, if there is something that you feel has been maybe negatively shone upon, and you feel, oh wait, actually we don't, that doesn't happen, making sure that you do highlight that. On LinkedIn, as I was saying, a lot of employee stories and positive sort of representation of your culture online will be able to show that maybe this was just a once off, or maybe there was a bit of a misunderstanding there, but actually as an overall company we do have these values and culture that we do like to show. And yeah, that the employer advocacy side of things, if people are showcasing that it's a great place to work, then hopefully these sort of bad reviews do filter through.
Yeah.
And you learn, understand, you communicate those things, and you be able to create a plan to then succeed and grow from that negative feedback.
So what you're saying there, if somebody goes onto Glassdoor, for example, and sees a negative review of your company, they're more likely to go and see what everybody else thinks via a different channel.
Hopefully, yeah. And we'll, if you've replied to it and you've made a conscious effort to go through and meticulously say the certain things that they've found and reply about them, then they can see that we've made an effort back. That so negative review.
Be diplomatic. It's effective what you're saying. You have to accept that when somebody leaves an organisation, yeah, they're not always going to be happy. Yeah. And there might be some valid points in there that do need addressing, and maybe you can improve as an organisation as a result.
Sometimes seeing things from an outside point of view, you notice things that nobody actually seen because they're so deep in the company. So sometimes when people leave, they see things from a different point of view. So it can actually be sometimes quite good to get that feedback. Yeah.
If you are worried though of, you know, what you were saying there, you know, you don't bother to leave a review when you've had a good experience, yeah, you only bother to do it when you've had a bad one, you need to actively be encouraging people to go and leave those reviews. So not just waiting for you to get a bad review and then asking 10 people in the company to go and leave a good review.
It's too obvious, right?
It just looks very false. Whereas if you're, you know, organically collecting those reviews over time, so you might have, you know, maybe a system in place that when somebody joins, you check in for feedback with them after a certain amount of time. You know, obviously once that's taken place, you maybe send them a link to your Glassdoor and they can go on and leave a review. So you're not putting a gun to someone's head saying, leave us a nice review. But if you're actually giving people an outlet and making it simple for them to leave those nice reviews, it's going to definitely take the edge off when you do get, well, I say when, it might never happen. But, you know, I think you'd be very lucky. I think even the best employers in the world will have a one-star review at some point.
We did think that about BrewDog, didn't we? But out.
Good
whistleblower employees.
Good point.
Showed that toxic culture, and some things, even though they seem amazing on the outside, actually aren't. So that negative feedback did come out and... Yeah.
It did. Yeah, they were on the receiving end, let's be honest, weren't they? A company that was, I don't know, considered to be one of the best on planet Earth from a cultural perspective. Yeah. Underneath the bonnet, it wasn't quite as clean cut as that.
Exactly so.
Yeah, there you go.
Be authentic.
You have to be authentic. Okay, so I feel like I'm asking you a lot of questions there, girls, but I'm trying to understand. So we're talking about the negative connotations attached there, right? But I feel like through a lot of trial and error and a lot of time committed and the effort that you girls have put in, I feel like Searchability do have quite a strong, a good, powerful, strong employer brand now. But how do you get recognised for having a strong employer brand? You're talking before about it not always being tangible, right? So how can people notice that you're doing a good job in that sphere?
Well, a couple of the obvious ways to do it is something that we're quite well versed in. It's looking at becoming an accredited best employer. So we've personally been through the best companies route.
We have.
For I think maybe 3 or 4 years, possibly even now. Essentially, you do have to pay a fee, but it's to conduct, employee engagement surveys. So they're quite, exhaustive in terms of the process that you have to do there. You can uncover some information about your company, learn, what your strengths are, what your weak spots are, and then look to how you can improve that. As part of doing that process, you are given a score.
Yeah.
And if your score is good, then you can potentially rank on their list of top 100 employers. So I think the best that we ever ranked was number 2.
Was it
number 2 best small company to work for in the UK?
I think best, was it best small company overall, not just recruitment?
Yeah,
any industry.
Yeah. Wow.
Which is pretty good.
We're the second best. Well, we're.
Yeah, so you have to have, I think they call it world-class levels of engagement to score for that. But even if you're not going to rank, it's still a really good process to go through because, again, it will give you all of that data that you can use to then look and go on and improve. But, there are other lists out there. So if you're, maybe a more global organisation, if you've got offices abroad, you might not want to go down the best companies route because it's quite UK centric. So you might look at, say, the top 100 employers, which is, available in different countries as well. Or there's obviously industry awards. Now, we won best employer brand at the Global Recruiter Awards.
Go on, girls.
A couple of years ago now. That was a fun afternoon out.
It was, wasn't it?
And then there's obviously awards like Recruiter Awards have their own category called Investing in Talent. So they have a lot of, awards for diversity and inclusion, candidate experience, etc. So there's lots of awards that you can kind of go down the route of. But I'd definitely say that, it's more important about what your people think about working for you. So if you can really kind of focus on that, getting the experience right, and then have that permeate into, strong employee advocacy online, that's, arguably more valuable.
Yeah.
Although it is quite nice to go to an award ceremony.
Yeah, it's always nice to get recognised for your achievements. And that accounts for anybody, doesn't it? Okay, cool. Well, where to go really? So, I don't know, maybe technology obviously is forever evolving. This is obviously focused on the employer branding side of things. So is there any particular, I don't know, how do I best describe this? I think how to word it. So are there any emerging markets perhaps, or any emerging technologies relevant to you guys that clients who are looking to invest in their employer brand need to focus on? Is there anything that's up and coming that perhaps people need to keep an eye out for?
Yeah, well, we've definitely seen since Soap's been doing it, it's probably been a dramatic change, but definitely since I've been doing it, there's been very much key trends in diversity, equality and inclusion. You could do a podcast on that on its own, definitely. It's a massive sort of trend at the moment. You want to be involved in that and making sure you do have a diverse pool of candidates within your business will sort of help with that. Hopefully we'll get the HR guys on here and they'll be able to speak for all of that and their sort of key pointers for that. But I do definitely think that is a trend within employer branding at the moment.
Yeah.
The next one, I'd go down the route of sort of sustainability and, as Sue said before, corporate responsibility. The sort of thing with all the renewables, eco-friendly, charities, local community. People do want to give back and sort anything they can. If you've sort of got a culture that maybe has, you get 3 days a year that you get to dedicate to a charity. Some people do look for that in employer brands. So I think that is definitely a trend that's been sort of up and coming a bit at the moment. Obviously, AI, artificial intelligence, ChatGPT, if anyone's on that at the moment. But
I think half of the office is on it, aren't they?
Exactly.
No, they are not.
But yeah, artificial intelligence, it is coming, and you do have to use it in sort of a hand in hand solution with humans. The whole thing about employee branding is it's a person orientated topic, so it's about the people, the culture. But there will be things like technologies and AI that you can integrate into that to maybe make your life easier. Maybe the surveys could be automatic. Things like that are going to help to with your employer branding. Definitely social media, as we've spoke about, the advocacy that you can use with that, posting about it, just using it as a really great hub to showcase your entire employer branding on. And we will be finding out about the actual trends in 2 weeks' time, because we're going to the World Employer Branding Day conference, which will be in Amsterdam this year.
Just drop that in there, yeah? Just
in.
Nice.
Yeah, we went to Lisbon last year, and I think it was the year before. But yeah, Amsterdam is the new location. So they do discuss sort of, we'll have companies like TikTok, Indeed, Google, head down there and discuss their point of view about employer brand in their business. So it's a really great insight, and they discuss key trends and topics. So yeah, we'll be finding out a whole lot of things there as well.
No, that sounds really cool. So for anyone that might be interested in attending that event, it's just like a bit of a fact find, is it, to see how they're,
yeah,
I don't know, the big companies are doing it, or do you get to see a little bit of everything?
Yeah, well, Sophie's actually been there as well.
Yeah, so yeah. I had to do a workshop at the Lisbon event back in 2019, which was pretty daunting, but I'd say it's probably absolute career high today.
Go on, Soph.
There's nothing like it, kind of speaking to a room of people that work within the industry that are actually listening to you, and you're actually giving them, you know, tasks.
Advice.
I think, if anything, a workshop feels more daunting than a presentation, because presentation, you speak and then you're off and then you don't have to deal with, whereas like a workshop, you're kind of there and they're asking questions, and if they're just looking at you like, you're talking about, then you just got to kind of die on stage for 45 minutes. But no, it went really well. So that's like a really, really good event. But this year we're not kind of going as partners. We're just there to enjoy and listen. But I'm pretty sure it's a sold out event.
Yeah,
but
it's now.
We'll be doing like plenty of tweets and some follow up content, and I'm sure the girls will be doing some TikToks.
Yeah, definitely.
Is it all three of you going? Yeah,
it is. Yes. Yeah.
Nice. That is exciting. You know what? When you guys talk about what you've done and the awards you've been recognized, I know this isn't supposed to be a platform to promote per se, but although you guys do offer this service to other recruitment companies, I think, you know, Searchability, we're a reputable agency and we've done well, but you guys do punch above your weight for the size of the company, and it's actually very, very impressive.
So, like in our industry, you'd be surprised, like, agencies aren't enormous. It's not like a recruitment agency.
Yeah,
you know, I think that's the thing, you're constantly comparing it to a recruitment agency of, you know, 60 70 80 people. You know, we're maybe a small handful of creatives, but you know, that is quite common actually of companies our size.
Okay.
You know, we're definitely in the boutique size, but you know, we can work with some big companies. We've worked with big brand names, you know, especially in the tech industry. And yeah, there's probably not a lot of agencies out there that have got all of their members of staff that have gone through a certified employer brand qualification.
Love it.
It's quite a niche area of marketing.
Yeah.
And I think that really kind of sets us apart from, you know, the competition. And especially in terms of, like you say, their recruitment agencies, because we do work with other agencies. You know, we have that kind of first-hand knowledge of how to look at, you know, the corporate brand as well as the employer brand, so we can support companies on both sides. So, you know, it's definitely a bit of a sweet spot for us.
Love that. Okay.
Yeah.
So let's summarise then.
Right.
we talk top five tips. Who are your top five tips aimed at? Is it prospective recruitment agencies who might be looking to invest or...
Yeah, I think recruitment, because this is a recruitment podcast, so yeah. We've kind of had our recruitment agency hat on throughout the whole thing, although yeah. A lot of these they concepts do translate to other industries. So I think top tip number one, I would say be open-minded and, you know, be prepared to listen to, you know, what your employees have got to say, because the best employer brands are built from the truth. And like we've kind of joked about, you know, negative comments on Glassdoor and feedback and, you know, how we'd love to bury our head in the sand. But at the end of the day, it'll only take you, you know, backwards if that's what you're doing. So the best companies are the ones that can actually listen and impact change from the inside out. So, you know, make sure you're kind of keeping an open mind and not being afraid to hear, you know, the good, the bad and the
awkward.
Ugly. I knew I was going to do that again. Those comments. But also just be patient, because when you are looking to make those changes, you know, it's very unlikely to be an overnight change.
Yeah. And then obviously once you are getting that feedback and change, you want the leaders, the directors, the head of talent, the head of marketing to all have buy-in on that, because if they don't believe in it, then who is going to, realistically? You need that commitment from the leadership team so that people, the employees maybe a bit further down, will be able to understand and bring that out themselves.
Like, I don't know, for example, a director of a recruitment company hosted a podcast, something like that.
Yeah. Yeah, we need you to believe in the employer brand. Yeah, top tip number three, I'd say, also leading on from what Leah said, you know, as well as the leadership, you need to think about those brand champions from within the business. So looking at people that are going to be good advocates of your employer brand, making sure you're giving them the tools to actually go out and showcase it. So thinking about that employer brand hashtag, championing visual content, so your videos, images, you know, making sure they're available to kind of post on different platforms. You know, a lot of people talk about social media guidelines in companies, but you don't want to be too rigid. So we always talk about more guidance versus guidelines. So one thing that we offer actually to clients, not to be a plug, but it's just coming out of my mouth, is we do like employee advocacy workshops. So we talk about best practice and we highlight suggestions of types of content they could share to showcase their EVP, because, you know, employees maybe wouldn't be thinking about that side of things. So it's like highlighting, you know, content that you can share. So it's not just about sharing from your social events. You know, for example, we have our First Fridays, which is our monthly social event. It happens on the first Friday of the month.
Smooth.
It's also talking about, you know, other elements of working for you. So you don't just want to focus on one side. You know, it might be sharing going to a conference. It might be sharing, you know, doing a workshop or something about the wellness day. So making sure people are aware of your whole employer brand and they can share content that's going to showcase that, so it's not just one-sided.
Yeah, and obviously if the people post in that, you want them to be authentic, is point number four. So what they're posting out there, you want to truly represent your employer brand and what you believe in. So you want that employer brand to actually be a true representation of yourself. Simple as that.
And then authenticity.
Like, yeah, the last step I'd say is just make sure you're actually taking the right steps in terms of discover, shape, promote your employer brand. So those six steps that we talked about before, that'll stand you in good stead. Obviously there is a little bit more to it, but we can't kind of get into the full nitty-gritty on this podcast. So if you feel overwhelmed, out of your depths, that you don't have the in-house knowledge, capability, budget, tools, resource to do this, then just reach out to a third party. You know, obviously, you know, there's us, but, you know, there's plenty of other companies out there. But, you know, if you come to us, then I'm sure we can holler podcast.
Plug number seven.
But yeah, I think you'll find it a lot easier to work with a third party that knows what they're doing. And a lot of the time, those processes like your employee engagement, it is better to be done from an external person, because you'll get a lot more authenticity in terms of the feedback from your employees.
Yeah, and being able to see it from an outside point of view does help, because some people just get blindsided and don't realise what's actually happening. So yeah, it can be great.
No, that makes sense. Now, girls, that's so helpful. I think we're very fortunate that we have you guys in-house. But I also see the work that you do for external clients, etc. And it does make a huge difference to all the things we've discussed today. I think it's fair to say that the girls could probably carry on talking about this for quite a while.
Yeah, we might launch our own podcast. Yeah. Assuming that we gave you the name the Holler Pod.
You're welcome.
We rebranded to Holler.
Thank you.
But we'll come up with a new name.
We're the best part of an hour in now, and I do feel like this could go on for longer. So for any listeners out there or any prospective clients interested in improving their employer brand, we will attach a little email so you can reach out to the ladies after the podcast's over. But to move things on, I'm going to have a quick overview of the director's diaries. It was a tricky one, this episode, I'm not going to lie. There's been many pods so far that I've not been fully versed within, but I think it's fair to say that I probably learned the most in this particular podcast. I know I see what you guys do. I know you run things by me at times, but to understand the intricacies is completely different. So it was a difficult one to try and bring background to recruitment. So I decided to keep it quite simple and just talk about the impact or the evolution that you guys have had on searchability in my time here. And maybe, potential other organisations can understand how we've benefited from it. So I'm going to keep it simple and focus on a couple of key points. I know Sophie touched on it earlier, but probably the most impactful thing that we've invested in is the top 100 best companies surveys. It's not always fun. You don't always hear what you want to hear. You don't always get the feedback that you want to get. But for those that don't know what this consists of, it's effectively an anonymous, is that right, Chloe? Anonymous, yeah?
The first time.
Ish, anonymous. It's not anonymous survey where all of your staff, well, they fill out a survey effectively, but they give an honest overview of how they feel about the organisation and what's good, what's bad, what could be better, where we can improve, etc. It can be quite costly, as I said, but it is pretty invaluable. And I think that every year that we've done this, we've taken quite a lot away from it and then inputted some of those improvements into the organisation, which have resulted in better scores as years have gone by. Which nicely leads me on to the second thing that we've introduced, which is all things associated with B Sound. Now, for those that don't know searchability, B Sound is our core value, and we want everybody in the company to be exactly that. B Sound. Martin Blythe, the MD, is from the Wirral. He's half Scouse, like Leah. And it's a common terminology that everybody uses in the office. But yeah. I think there was a period of time so where we maybe felt like only the old school or the senior management, for example, really understood what that actually meant.
I feel like, it wasn't like a structured value. It was just like an unwritten thing of like, oh, you've got to be sound. Like,
yeah.
So when, you were surveying people in that first year of the best company saying, how much do you think the leaders live the value? It was no surprise that even though you were all sound,
thank you,
we're scoring high on that because it wasn't really like a defined value. So I think, that's probably something that we learned, isn't it?
Yeah, no, it is. And we introduced a few things on the back of that, including the monthly B Sound Award. I think recruitment agencies historically, I know they get the industry's changed a lot now, but we always promoted and shouted about the best billers are not necessarily those people that were the unsung heroes who were doing a lot of good behind the scenes. Now, the people who've made an actual difference to your day-to-day rather than just the revenue on the board. So we introduced the monthly B Sound Award where absolutely anybody in the organisation can win that award just for making a difference. And I think that's been pretty well received.
It's like a monthly reminder then. People can't forget about it if you're kind of reminding people. I do remember winning that once though, and a picture went on LinkedIn and my parents were like, I'm so proud of you, and I was like, it's just like an internal thumb thing, as if I'd like won an Oscar. I was like,
well, ironically I feel like that award is very rarely won by recruiters. It isn't. Which boy tells us everything we need to know. I mean, I was one. And again, as a knock-on effect of that, we also introduce field sound hours, which I think when I explain what this is, will probably terrify a lot of businesses out there. But it really does. It really does work for us. You know, we offer new members of staff and up to senior members between 16 and 24 hours field sound a year, which is effectively the option to book an hour off whenever you feel like, no explanations needed. You want an extended lunch, you want to leave early on a Friday, you want to have an extra hour in bed, you can take it, no questions asked. Which I was a little bit unsure about at first. But, you know, it works for us. And the reason it works for us is because almost everybody, or the vast majority, are massively bought into the culture. We had hired wrong in the past, and maybe it didn't work for those people. But when you get to where we are now, it makes a huge difference. You do have to be, obviously, cautious about those perks that you introduce. But I think when you implement these things into any environment, you don't want it to just be about the culture. So you can hire the wrong people. But I think, you know, if you're careful with that and you've got the right culture, it can really work. A lot of this has obviously been implemented by you guys, and we can't thank you enough. So yeah, you know, it's, you have to strike that balance, but it's been a good move for us, and it's worked. So, you know, having that core value has made a huge difference. Definitely. I feel like I rambled on there, but you get the point.
No, I think that was great.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Right.
So you do this for a living.
Well, I definitely don't do it for a living. It's a side hustle.
Side hustle. A bit like Leah's side hustle. DJ Leah Cottam.
Yeah.
Oh, well,
is that your DJ name?
Bobby, just so everyone knows.
DJ Bobby.
It is.
What does that even mean?
It's just a long story of friendship nicknames that has arrived to this.
To DJ Bobby. Which, it's almost like you set that up there, Soph.
Oh.
Which,
almost as if I wrote the story.
Almost. Which leads us beautifully onto our final segment, which is the wrap-up record.
It is.
The wrap-up record. Well, we basically ask our guests to choose a favourite record. It might be relevant to the podcast. Hint, hint. It could be relevant to, I don't know, that's their favourite tune. It could be anything, effectively. And I can tell, by the way, that Soph set up that Leah's going to be choosing today's wrap-up record.
Yes, yes.
Before we do, though, Soph, what would you have gone for?
Oh, so, you know me, I'm a big Beyoncé fan.
No.
So I'm sure it would have been a Beyoncé song, and I would have made you sit down and watch me do a full performance.
She would have actually just sang. It wouldn't have been played.
Yeah. So I would have danced, Leah.
So today's wrap-up record has now gone back to Sophie.
And I will be, tonight I'm going to be singing.
Tonight, Matthew.
I won't do that to the listeners of the viewers.
Come on, DJ Bobby, what have you got for us?
We're going to go with Gwen Stefani, Holler Back Girls, because we are the Holler Back Girls.
Love it. So to wrap us up, it's Gwen Stefani, Holler Back Girls.
Love it.
Cheers.
Woo.
Oh, this my shit. All the girls stomp your feet like this. Few times I've been around that track, so it's not just gonna happen like this.